It is my privilege once again to welcome you, and we wish you, although your visit is very short, we wish you a very pleasant stay in Mayo College. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Today we'll begin the performance by depicting the dawn at Mayo College. Let us transpose into this world of nature with the Mayo Fusion Band rendering Morning Happiness.
Members of the General Council, ladies, gentlemen, and friends. On behalf of all present here, I take this opportunity to express our heartfelt gratitude to the Honorable Vice President for sparing his precious time to visit Mayo College and interacting with students.
If you could change one thing about our country, what would it be and why?
I think the most important thing that we as a people need is discipline. I'll explain to you why. There was an old philosopher who wrote an essay, which some of you might read later on in your studies, My Station and Its Duties. Now, we are all citizens of India. What are the duties of the citizens of India? That is the discipline that we need to understand, each one of us. But if we have ambiguity, if we are uncertain about it, then we will find excuses of why this could not be done, why that could not be done. So discipline is the most important thing. And I think if you look around the world and you look at history, the most successful people have been those who have been disciplined in terms of their national ideas.
So how relevant is the existence of an upper house of the parliament whose members are not directly elected by the people of the country?
I get your question. Let me answer it. It is not correct to say that members of the upper house are not elected. They're simply elected by a different system. But let me come to the rationale of a second house. The whole purpose is to make sure that when you are legislating, you are considering all points of view, looking at a proposal from all possible angles. Sometimes it happens, and it has happened in our own history on many occasions. You sometimes read about it in newspapers that a legislative proposal has been passed in 2 minutes. Now it might look a statistical impossibility for 500 odd people to pass a proposal in 2 minutes. But this does happen. And then we live with the consequences. If you have not examined every proposal carefully from all possible angles, every word, every comma, every full stop has a meaning. And if something has been done in a hurry or done carelessly, then what do we find? We find in 6 months the matter is before a court of law. So instead of doing good through a proposal, we are doing the opposite. The matter will go from one court to another court till it reaches the highest court, and it may take 2 years or it may take 10 years. So the whole purpose of a second legislative chamber is to get a second viewpoint on proposals and get a second viewpoint from different angles. I am looking at this building here from this side. But how do I know that it may look differently from the left or the right? I have to go through that process. That is the logic of a second chamber, and that is the reason why in many democratic countries, though not in all,
whom do the politicians look up to? Who has been your inspiration?
I think we all have to look up to the same idea. We are a great people, we are a great country. We are a unique country in the world. And what makes us unique? We were enslaved. We found a way of getting rid of that slavery. We did it in a way that is being written about in textbooks the world over. So our ideal and inspiration is stick to those values, which helped us reach so far in a long journey. It's not complete. I look forward to it. And I know that this journey will be complete only when our inspiration becomes reality.
Has our education system become more marks-oriented than knowledge-oriented?
I'm afraid I agree with you. When I read in the newspapers that you need 99% marks to enter a college in Delhi, I'm amazed, because when I was a student, and that was more than half a century back, nobody ever got 99% marks except students of mathematics. I think we have, I don't know whether we have diluted standards, but we have changed standards. And I don't think this change is producing the right kind of results. The purpose of education is acquisition of knowledge, not a mark sheet which looks good. Mark sheet is only one of the ways of reflecting it. But if you simply get 100 out of 100 and you know nothing about your subject, will you be considered educated? So something has gone wrong, but I don't know the answer how it can be corrected. I think the country is struggling to find the answer.
In your opinion, what can India do to ensure that its best minds do not migrate in search of greener pasture?
Do the best minds go away? I don't think so. I think the best are still here. But we only hear about the ones who go away. So we have to find out the reason. One is an individual answer, about which neither you nor I can take a view. If somebody wants to go away, he goes away, she goes away. Some people go away because they get better emoluments or they get better facilities. Now, it is true that we cannot give the kind of salaries that you can get in a developed country. And we are poor in providing facilities for research. But in spite of that, you still have. I recently spent some time talking to a group of people in Bombay who are all working in Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. And the things that they told me there was absolutely amazing. The kind of work which is being done by scientists in our own country. You have recently seen a much publicized example, the mission to Mars. Doesn't it prove to you that the talent is here? The talent is not going away, but we can give more facilities to the talent. I think that is where the challenge is. One reason for that is that our social values have unfortunately changed. We don't honor a teacher as we used to honor a teacher. We don't honor a scientist as we used to honor a scientist. We don't honor a researcher as we should. These are people who think. Why do they think? There was a group of young boys and girls who came to see me yesterday. They have all got innovation awards. These are class 10 and under. Their patents are pending with the patent office. So obviously the mind is there, the talent is there, people are thinking. So don't feel, don't feel disappointed or despondent about it. I think we've got a great deal of talent in the country. Some are going away. I think we can do with that.
What advice do you like to give to the youth?
Do the best you can in whatever you are doing. Be optimistic. Don't be pessimistic. Pessimism takes you nowhere. Be optimistic. Be sure that you will reach the target. And keep walking.
Sir, higher education in India is in shambles and cannot be compared to countries such as the US and the UK. How serious is this drawback and how can we deal with it?
Well, the drawback is serious because we started much later. You see, if you look at the better known universities in the world, some of them have existed for a few centuries. So quality takes time to develop. It all goes back to standards and disciplines. We have unfortunately fallen into the trap of trying to do things in a hurry. Higher education ke liye, ya even school education ke liye, quality bahut zaruri hai. Uske baghair quality ke nahi hoga. Hamara benchmark sirf ek hona chahiye, target sirf ek hona chahiye. Quality.
Having observed the policy changes in education closely, can you compare the pros and cons of the present education system with the one at your time?
Would it not involve a conflict of interest if I were to pronounce on that? I think I liked the educational system in my time. I think I learnt a great deal at that time. I am sure Zionists would also agree, others would also agree. But this is a serious debate. You know, The world has changed. The world is changing. So we can't say that what was good 100 years back is good today. That is not the issue. We have to respond to the challenges of the day. The question to ask is, are we responding to the challenge correctly? So it does not matter whether it is the system of today or system of yesterday, but are we answering the challenge? If the answer is yes, we should be happy. If the answer is no, then there is something wrong. I think there is a great deal of debate in the public, there is a great deal of debate in the media about the shortcomings or alleged shortcomings of our educational system. The Honorable Rashtrapatiji has spoken about it very frequently. Government has set up different committees to go into this matter. The point is that our educational standards have slipped, despite all the progress that we have made. There was a time when a degree from a university in India would qualify you for admission into the best university in the country. Today it's not so. We do not rank amongst the top universities. Why is it? There is something wrong, but I think it will require a much longer discussion than a question hour session to find out the answers. But do think about it, and if you have any ideas, do share it with your fellow students, share it with your teachers, share it with me if you find the time.
Good evening, sir. Owing to the lack of international exposure, our country ranks 151st in soccer internationally. Don't you think our governments have ignored the development of sports in India?
Yes, the government has ignored and society has ignored. Go outside your fabulous campus and look at an average school within this city. How many of them have sports fields? I'm talking of average, what are known as municipal schools. We have paid no attention to sports. That is an honest truth. Again, it gets linked to the other question that we have started taking school education as a matter of getting marks. So parents don't want the children to go out and play. Schools don't provide the facilities for developing prowess in sports. And the net result is that the age group in which you can find talent is being neglected. If we still find a good player, that is by accident, it is not by design. Nobody can take credit for it, except the individual. So I agree with you that this is something that needs to be done. It needs to be done at the school level.
Thank you, sir.
Why is the decision-making process so slow, especially the formulation of laws?
I don't think the process of formulation of laws is slow. As I explained in answer to an earlier question, it should not be hissed. We have to be careful. But having said that, formulation of laws is only one part. Our legal system is slow. Our administrative system is slow. And sometimes our legislative system is slow. I said the Parliament of India sits only for 70 to 75 days. So the process becomes slow because we don't devote enough attention to it.
In your tenure as the Vice President of India, have you ever faced a situation when you wanted to quit?
Not yet.
Which role has been more challenging to you, the role of a bureaucrat or the vice president?
Each role has its own challenge. I can't really prioritize this or that. When I was a professional diplomat, the challenges were different. when I was a university vice chancellor, there were different kind of challenges. When I was chairing a government commission or committee, again the challenges were different. Well, vice president of India wears two hats, not one. He's vice president of India and he's chairman of the Rajya Sabha. As chairman of the Rajya Sabha, he is like a referee in a football game or a hockey game. This is a huge country. It's a very diverse country. You need to communicate all the time with people. And this is one of the offices of the state, one step lower than that of the Rashtrapati ji, where you need to constantly communicate with the public, public in all its manifestations. So I think I would find it difficult to prioritize, and I'm happy not prioritizing.
So, if you were to be reborn in India, which state would you choose and why?
But let me tell you, I was born in West Bengal. I was educated all over. So, I am a citizen of India and I am comfortable in any part of India. I am sure if I were to be born again, wherever I am born, I'll be equally happy. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Do you think that the reservation system in our country is justified?
You read the first page of the Constitution, you will get all this. Now, if I want to make sure that everybody is getting that equality, then I must take steps to ensure that that equality is forthcoming. So I would desist from using the word reservation. And I will substitute it with another word which has a better meaning, empowerment. So the whole purpose of the what we call reservation system is to make sure that those who are less fortunate, they are raised to the level when they can compete equally. That is all. That is all.
Sir, what are your views on abolishing capital punishment in India?
My personal views, which are only personal views, I think the debate in the world is going against capital punishment. Except a few countries, very few countries, capital punishment has been abolished. There are better ways of punishing people. So, my personal view is that this is a subject on which and we should think about it seriously.
Sir, after a long day at work, how does the Vice President of India wind up?
Take a book and read it. This has been a very pleasant learning experience. But I have learned so much today. I have listened to some superb music. I have had the opportunity of meeting so many young people with some very sharp questions. I hope I was able to answer them with pass marks, if not anything better than that. But I really would like to thank everyone here, minus of course principals, the members of the Board of Trustees, the teachers, the students, the well-wishers of the school. Thank you very much for inviting me. I enjoyed it.